I'm Edith Nabas. I'm very, very happy to be here today connected with you and to present a small glimpse of my research. I'm a PhD student from the University of Leipzig in Germany, and my research explores the temporal, spatial, and social dimensions of the urban night in Bobo-Dioulasso, the second largest city of Burkina Faso. And I did 10 months of field work in Burkina Faso in 2018-2019. And the data I will present then today is issued from this extensive empirical research in Bobo-Dioulasso. So the topic I will present today about taxi drivers, taxi space, is not particularly a focus in my dissertation, but is in fact an important aspect of my research, and especially of my relationship with the field. So from the beginning of the field work, I started accompanying taxi drivers along their night rides around 2 times a week, and I kept doing this all along my field research. So it has really deepened my research on the methodological level in terms of knowing the city and knowing those who inhabit the city at night. I drove along with 6 different drivers, relatively young men from 25 to 45. And while I was sitting most often on the back seats, the drivers were still taking passengers, so sitting on the front seat or next to me. The night in Bobo-Dioulasso falls early between 6 and 7 p.m. all along the year. But the working night for the nocturnal taxi drivers starts mostly around 9 or 10 p.m. and ends in the morning. So today at the night, I will consider the night which is appropriated, experienced, and produced by the drivers and their passengers. So one which starts late and ends late, penetrating largely through what we might call the day. So my contribution will look at the quotidian trajectories of taxi drivers and passengers at night and approach the practices and possibilities characterizing the navigation, which I think are very interesting lens to observe the interdependencies of the night. So to examine the taxi space and to go beyond the dichotomies that are often characterizing it, I propose to look at it as an in-between space, a liminal space, or a threshold. So I will start by introducing very fast the concept of threshold, then I will present you some elements of the quotidian nights of taxi drivers and their passengers drawn on my own experience. And finally, we will try to decorticate the taxi space and explore the potentialities it offers. So a few words on the concept of liminality and threshold spaces. Liminality was first used in 1999 by Genep in his work Les Rites de Passage, and later in 1969 by Turner, referring to a paradoxical and ambiguous passage between 2 spaces, 2 worlds. This concept was used in this context to designate the transitional and dislocated stage of the rite de passage, namely of the initiation. So both authors and later a large body of literature on space and space-time went further describing all the ambiguous and disorienting in-between experiences. So for me, threshold describes a space which at the same time connects and separates, assembles and divides. And it's also creative, energizing, transgressive space, which is very importantly characterized by its own fluidity, making and breaking boundaries, and translocating, metamorphosing itself temporally, socially, and spatially. So I find it very interesting to look at the taxi space through this concept of the threshold to depict a very porous in-between space producing the togetherness of materiality and immaterialities, subjective and ambivalent aims, feelings, and experiences. So looking through the threshold space in its complexities and fluidities, I think can tell us a lot about the city and the night. So before we start demonstrating that, I would like to show you this map. This map has been realized by my colleague Utkana Zoe, who is doing research on taxi, but during the day, sorry, because it's in French, but it shows the city and the points are the landmarks, nocturnal spaces such as cafe, bars, and so on. So the city actually gets much further than the map shows, but we use data from the Minister of Urbanism of Burkina Faso, and those data only includes legal and planned neighborhoods and thus conceal spontaneous neighborhoods at the margins of the city where actually a great part of the dwellers live, which of course also adds its political implications, but yeah. So as you can see, the triangle in the middle here is the former colonial city and the city center now in Bobo-Dioulasso, and it's mostly paved and illuminated. The nocturnal sites or places, as we can call them, are, as you can see, in the city center or all along this main boulevard, which is called the Boulevard de la Révolution, after the revolution of Thomas Sankara in 1983. And the whole rest of the city and further, which is, however, the largest part of the city and where the dwellers live, is left dark and unpaved and almost invisible. So now I will describe a bit my own experiences in taxi drivers and along a night. So describe a night in a taxi. So usually a taxi driver picks me up around 9 or 10 PM when he starts walking. So in Bobo-Dioulasso, the only collective means of transportation at night is the taxi. In the daytime, people navigate also with tricycles or buses, but they would stop driving around 7 or 8 PM. So from 10, whereas men going outside at night mostly have their own motorbikes or bicycles, the mobility of women, especially those walking at night in the pleasure or sexual economy, depends on taxi. They are mostly foreigners from Côte d'Ivoire, Ghana, Mali, or Nigeria, staying only for a few months in Bobo-Dioulasso and then going further. At night, contrary to their daily practices, drivers don't circulate more or less randomly or at a really shared taxis, but keep deliberately waiting for the calls of their clients. So in the taxi, we await potential calls from female clients calling from home in the periphery and who want to be picked up and get brought to their working places around the city center. The city is empty and silent except from the few archipelagos of lights in the city center and along the boulevard. This phase lasts mostly until 1 a.m. And then we often take a break, we drink a beer together in a bar until the phone starts ringing again. So around 3 a.m., most of the bars are closing and the female navigators want either to go home to a friend's place or to other clubs remaining open until morning. From then on, the phone keeps ringing and ringing incessantly until morning. So the velocity of the nocturnal activities accelerates increasingly. I think that to follow the rhythm of the taxi is to understand the rhythm of the night, which checks up the perception of the 24-hour cycles. While the night of consumption is often considered as a surplus time, the people who walk at night experience it very quick and a lot more shifting than the day. Around 6 or 7, often later, when the last women are still awake, sometimes accompanied, they want to drum home. And the sun has already risen. The city is awake, people are heading to the markets, children to the school, and the last clients of the bars are having one last beer and negotiating how and whom they can go home with. So my driver and I, we will get a coffee together around 9 and then we will go home. So now let's look at the different spaces and experiences co-constituting and constituted by the taxis and making the taxi spaces. So first of all, looking at the taxi in its materiality, we see a blurred physical space. The cars are old, sometimes without windows. One communicates permanently with the outside, ordering cigarettes or listening to the conversation of the motorbikes at the red traffic light, and who might ask the woman inside the taxi for their numbers. In its materiality, the taxi space embodies thus an in-between space, a semi-closed and semi-private space allowing the movement of the bodies inside, but without the opacity with the outside. The drivers and the passengers know each other. They see each other almost every night. So except for the travelers, for instance, picked up at the bus station, the taxi rides are not anonymous and not just also a mobile infrastructure. The social status of most of the taxi clients in Burkina Faso, the woman working at night, is not higher than the one of the drivers. They are both representatives of a certain marginalized class of the society trying to make a living at night. So in spite of their uncommon backgrounds, they share common needs, both as nocturnal workers. The taxi space remains a sort of collective and solidary space where both as workers are fighting against the others, and particularly against the men, the clients of the woman, and the clients of the driver. Those men who enjoy the night economy will, for instance, will have to pay a lot more than the woman. So the gender character of the encounters between drivers and these female passengers is in a way deconstructed. The role of the drivers move way beyond their status as male drivers and navigate between being a big brother, a friend, and sometimes even a lover. So taxi spaces embody spaces of confidences and trust. The passengers will ask the driver if he can help her with a man, or they will help each other with money, share drugs and advices. The taxi drivers and the women also share a sort of common illegal status. Taxis in Bobo-Dioulasso use gas bottles instead of fuel, and this self-made system does not allow them to get an insurance or to pass the technical control. And as well, the women, they don't possess paper, or at least don't take them with them at night. So in this way, the taxi space embodies a moving safe island, which permanently tries to avoid encounters with the police. If they don't succeed in that, they would resist side by side against the policeman, negotiating and sharing the fine or giving out a mobile number of a woman. So taxi spaces form in this way a reordering space while disordering the social, formal and daily order. Landmarks at night are the bars, clubs, or drug dealing places, and the houses of the clients. These are places which are not known by the majority of the city dwellers, but only exposed to those who make, share, and navigate the night and its territorialities. So in this case, the taxi is also a space of learning, especially for the women who are not from the city, but acquire in the taxi the language of the city, its landmarks and potentialities, also the ways how to behave, how to act, how to move. So the taxi experience is the manifestation of the learning of a particular knowledge of the city, but which makes the knowledgeable belonging to the night worlds as reordering spaces and also belonging to the city. The taxi ride embodies also a transition between work, performance, sometimes violence, and the needed shelter where the female workers can rest and interact before penetrating into the night, going to work or in between. So this threshold space offers also potentialities concerning the metamorphosing of identities and the passage between different worlds sheltered from the gaze of the daily traditional order in a predominantly Islamic city. Many women leave their veils and a long cape in the taxi that they would take back later when the taxi would carry them home. So in the semi-opacity of the taxi, they make themselves invisible under the mask of the night. Under the sunlight, they will always put something on before going out of the car and penetrating the daily practices of the periphery. Often also on our way to bring passengers back home late in the night, we share the car with women or men going to the market. Suddenly, the space got silent. We were made invisible. The transitional taxi space started entering in the new phase, and one could feel the tensions. The power relations were being inversed. The exclusive character of the taxi space, protecting from and disordering the social daily order, was being reversed. We were crossing this very temporal, spatial, and social transitional fluid phase, which might be called the morning, where the different spheres are intersecting and identities mutate again until the next evening. So to conclude, I have tried to show with this element that the taxi space needs materialities and immaterialities embodies a fluid threshold space, which simultaneously separates and connects, disorders and reorders, implies the transformation and moving of identities, of social status, and thus help us to go way beyond the dichotomies day and night, outside, inside, public, private, being a continuous but moving in between. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lid. Very interesting and a lovely place. I have no the pleasure to be there, but you know, in my agenda. Let me ask is if Peter Tinko is here. No. Well. So. It's a pity. So thank you very much. We are going to Caroline. Are you here, Caroline? Right. Hello. Okay. So now it's time for the presentation of Caroline Kramer about nighttime commuting in Germany. Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, that's me, huh? But when I stop it, I will give the presentation.
The phases and so on. Okay.
He's the PhD and it's his work, so he will do the presentation and I will join the discussion later. Okay. So.
Okay.
Hello, everybody. I'm trying to start my presentation. Okay. So you as a host need...
allow the sharing.
Yeah, can you allow
Co-host right now? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, here it is.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, can you see it?
Yeah.
Okay, nice. So, hello everybody, my name is Jonas Kapitzer. I'm a PhD student at the Karlsruhe University. And today I want to give you some insight into my study, which is entitled Out at Night, Human Geographic Research on the Users of Nocturnal Work Trips. Here you can see my structure. First, I want to tell something about the problem on which the study is based on, then something about the state of research. Then my leading questions, some theoretical considerations I've made, then the thesis, the data and methods I used, and last but not least, the results and a little bit of discussion and outlook. So let's start with the problem. So the problem concerns two big research topics. So on one hand, we have the field of the night studies, where a lot of publications and professional articles are in about topics of the evolution of the nighttime economy, of changing meanings and experience of urban darkness and nights, the intensification of regulation, and so on. And then on the other hand, there is the big field of the studies on mobility. And there's an incalculable number of publications And these authors I listed here are mainly published studies on well-being during commuting. So, but when we combine these two topics together, there's only a small amount of publications, and I only found one article about nocturnal work trips. So here I see a big research gap, and I would like to fill this research gap a little bit by providing a few contributions on nighttime mobility of workers. When we look at the topic of the nighttime mobility and of the research, which is already there, and interpret the results of the research, which is already available, we can see two observations. So the first is that there's generally increased demand on natural mobility, especially in the bigger cities or on the urban regions. And then on the other hand, there is a low supply for public transport. So I don't want to say that there is no supply at all. There is, and the most cities have expanded the nighttime transport service in the last decade. But there's still a lack of supply, and especially in comparison, with the traffic offered during the day, there is a lag. And the cities and towns are reducing the public transport service during the night. So this lower offer in the city, or no offer in the rural area, leads in a consequence that there is a limited and restricted access to the night, especially to the night as a whole for some people. And if you think of people who live far away from the city or have no car or no money to pay a taxi, they are excluded. So when we ask ourselves, why are people out at night anyway? There are two main reasons why people travel at night. The first reason is work, and the second reason is leisure. And so far the research has focused more on the aspects of nighttime leisure mobility, but there are at least as many people who travel at night for work reasons. And at this point, I'd like to quote Plüschteva, who says, a greater attention to the needs of those who are mobile at night for work rather than leisure is needed if nocturnal cities are to become more inclusive. And this leads us to my leading questions for this presentation, which are, first, who are the people who travel to work at night? When do they travel to work at night? And which mode of transport do they choose for the nocturnal work trip? So I am especially interested in the nocturnal work trips. And when we talk about nocturnal work trips, we have to think about what is a nocturnal work trip. So when we think about nocturnal work trip, we have to think of the night and ask ourselves, what is night? And we can define night on some different aspects. The first is that we can see night as a natural phenomenon, as a phenomenon with a daily sunrise, daily sunset, as a phenomenon where one part of the day is a light, the other part of the day is in darkness. And then we can see, especially out of the perspective of a human geographer, that night is also a spatial-temporal construct. So a construct to which meanings can be attributed to and imaginations can be extracted from. So night can also be produced, it can be used by people, it can be experienced by people, and it can be regulated. And then we can see night as a space of problems and fear, as a space of contact, of leisure and possibilities, or as a space of protection or work. But all these definitions have the problem that there is no clear frame of the night. So it's not really clear how you can define the night. So what I did for pragmatical reasons for my analysis, I framed the night by a time frame, and I see the night as a period of time. So here you can see the time beam, and I choose a clear starting point for the night and a clear end point for the night. So my starting point is at 10 p.m. and my end point is at 6 a.m. And now we have a frame for pragmatical reasons. And this frame is oriented on the German Labor Protection Act. And in Germany, there is the time of silence in it. And it's a time of night surcharge where people earn more money when they work at night. So, and this period of time has some characteristics. It's it's a characteristic of silence. It's a characteristic of abandonment. And in a year, less than 20% of all sunrises and sunsets fall within this period, which conversely means that it is characterized by complete darkness in more than 80% of the cases. And when we talk about a trip, we can see the trip as an active process with translocal position change, and a work trip is a trip with work as the main purpose. And if you have a work trip within the period of this nighttime, we can talk about a nocturnal work trip. And here it's important that I only choose trips who are completely in this frame of the night, in this nighttime period, and not if they are started before 10 p.m. and reached into the nighttime, or if they started into the nighttime and reached in the morning. This, in my in my thing, it's not these are not working trips. So now that it's clear what's a working trip, I would like to show you my thesis based on the questions. So the first question was, who are the people who travel to work at night? And if you think about the people, we don't only have to think about people who work while night, but also about people who work into the night, or which works start at night and reach into the morning, because they have also a work trip at night as well. And the most workers who work late into the night can be found in the sectors of hospitality, of industry, hospitality industry, in the retail, health, and social services. And other occupations with atypical working hours are protection, security, and surveillance occupations, as well as occupations that are related to driving vehicles and transport equipment, as often can be found in the logistics sector. And all of these occupations have in common that they require training, so they are training occupations. So my first thesis is that the majority of the nocturnal work trips are made by persons with a lower or medium level of education. The second question was, when do they travel to work at night? And while in the health and social service, the same number of people are expected to work continuously during the night. During the week, the situation is different in the hospitality and leisure sector, particularly regarding on the increasing nighttime economy. It is to be expected that an above average number of night workers will be needed, especially at the weekends. So cumulatively, viewed across all sectors, the thesis to be examined is that the proportion of all nocturnal work trips are approximately equal distributed throughout the week. And the third question was, which mode of transport do they choose for the nocturnal work trip? And in consideration of the restricted offer of public transport services, my thesis is that in comparison between daytime and nighttime work trips at night, the use of public transport is underrepresented. To test the thesis, I used the database Mobility in Germany from the year 2017. This is a nationwide survey by the Federal Administration of Transportation and Digital Infrastructure. Its field phase was from May 2016 until September 2017. And more than 300 persons were interviewed, and more than 960,000 trips were recorded. The collected data included the departure and arrival time of each trip, the purpose of travel, and some social demographic factors. And I looked at the nighttime trips, and I found 29,000 nighttime trips in this data set, which is 3.1% of all trips. Okay, let's come to the results and discussion. At first, I want to show you the distribution of the trip purposes. I always show you the night in comparison to the day, but I only tell something about the night. So here we can see that 44% of all nighttime trips had the purpose of work, and 41% had the purpose of leisure, and then 50% had other purposes. When we take a look at the characteristic qualities of persons with nighttime work trips, we can see that 70% of the nighttime work trips were made by male. More than 50% of the nighttime work trips were made by persons with the age between 40 and 59 years old. And more than 72% of the nighttime work trips were made by persons which had a primary school leaving certification or a lower or intermediate secondary school leaving certification. And here you can see the distributions of the nocturnal work trip purposes over the course of the week. And if you look at the first bar, you can see that around 55% of the nocturnal work trips of the nocturnal trips were made at the night from Monday to Tuesday between 10 p.m. and 6 a.m. Had the purpose of work, and around 25% had the purpose of leisure. So if you look at the yellow line, you see the share of the respective day in the total weekly nighttime traffic volume in total. And we can see that the highest nocturnal traffic volume in Germany is on Saturday night. So why is it like this? For this question, we have to look at these lines. And here you can see the share of the respective day in total weekly nighttime traffic volume per purpose. So the dark green line shows the purpose of work. The olive green line represents the purpose of leisure. And we can see that most nighttime trips, nighttime working trips were made between Monday and Friday. And then on the weekend, only a few nocturnal trips happened. But there's still the highest nocturnal traffic volume on Saturday. And the reason for this are the leisure trips, which are made in the nights from Friday to Sunday. Yeah, and at last, I want to show you some modal split of the work trips. And we can see that 71% of the nocturnal work trips were made by car, and only 11% were made by public transport services. And in comparison to today, this is a lower number, so lower amount of people use the public service during the night for the purpose of work on the trips. So when we come back our questions and we ask who are the people who travel to work at night, we can say these are mainly men between the age of 40 and 59 years old with a lower or intermediate level of education. So the first thesis can be confirmed. Then when do they travel to work at night? We can say mainly on the nights between Monday or Friday. So the thesis that the proportion of all nocturnal work trips are approximately equal distributed throughout the night cannot be confirmed. And which mode of transport do they choose for the nocturnal work trip? We see that more than 2 out of 3 people with nighttime trips use the car, and only a small amount use the public transport services. So the third thesis can be confirmed. Yeah, what I'm going to do next, I want to analyze an own survey during the night in the terms of Karlsruhe. Then I want to do a more precise data analysis on the choice of means of transport of persons with nighttime work trips, and some exploratory studies on the perception of nocturnal working routes. Okay, here again, I don't know why. Yeah, if you want to contact me, that's my name and my email address, and thank you.